Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of our God that we wish to consider for ourselves is found and quoted for us in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 30, verses 19 through 20. This day I call heaven and earth as witnesses against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live, and that you may love the Lord your God. Listen to his voice and hold fast to him, for the Lord is your life. Thus far, God's word, let you and I continue with prayer. O gracious and merciful Father, we give you thanks for the wonder and marvel of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. What a joy it is, even in the Old Testament, to hear about him, to contemplate him, and to grasp what it is that he has done for us. In Jesus we pray, amen. This particular section of scripture is really so challenging. Deuteronomy is a book where Moses is getting ready to depart from this world as the Lord God has informed him. And as he's getting ready, his concern is not for himself. His concern is rather with the people of Israel, that group of kids that had been freed from the slavery of Egypt. See, it was a group that had watched God's judgment upon their parents as they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. Do you remember that? God had decreed that all of that generation of parents of the Exodus, because of their persistent disobedience and defiance of God, until they died out, the people of Israel would not be allowed to enter into the promised land. Can you imagine what that must have been like? Wandering around, watching a whole generation of people die because of ungodliness. Your parents and their friends dying as you wait to have God fulfill his promise of the promised land. And yeah, I want you to know that that generation of kids who are now the leaders, they were not filled with bitterness and hatred for the Lord, but they were filled with faith and love for the Lord. You see, they understood their parents' sin. They understood the Lord's graciousness and his righteous judgment upon their parents. And these kids grew up with a solid faith and confidence in the Lord. So now, as they get ready to approach the promised land, they also learned that Moses will be taken from them too. For you see, Moses was forbidden from entering that land because he dishonored the Lord God. And so, yes, Moses is getting ready to die. God will show him the land, and then God will take Moses to himself. And as I said before, in all this, Moses is not concerned for himself. Rather, he's concerned for the people of Israel. He knows the temptations and the follies of the world. He knows the difficulties of the years ahead for them as they are going in and conquering and settling the land. Moses knows the lure of the worship of the world to abandon the true God and to follow false gods that appear more appealing and more in keeping with our human needs and wants. So Moses spends considerable time encouraging his people. He reminds them of God's goodness and love. He reviews with them God's law, all of God's law, his civil law, his ceremonial law, and his moral law. Because that law was to be their guide and their help. And Moses spurs them on to faithfulness and trust in the Lord God now and always. Our chapter and its readings are the pinnacle of what Moses desires for his people. The words are forceful. The choice presented is not shades of gray, but rather is light and dark. Really, the choice of faith. Let you and I contemplate these words, and let you and I work at the challenge of applying them to ourselves. And our theme will be the challenge. First, blessings and curses. Second, life. Third, love. Now, I think to fully understand this particular section, you need to realize what was said in verses 11 through 14. See, verses 11 through 14 is important because it gives you the direction. It gives you the base for every choice presented before these people of Israel. In other words, if it wasn't for what is said in verses 11 through 14, I don't think there is a challenge. I don't think there is a choice. There's not anything positive to discuss or consider. Those verses say this. Now, what I am commanding you today is not too difficult for you or beyond your reach. It is not up in heaven, so that you have to ask, who will ascend into heaven to get it and proclaim it so we may obey it? Nor is it beyond the sea, so that you have to ask, who will cross the sea to get it and proclaim it so we may obey it? No. The word is very near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart, so you may obey it. Do you see why I say this is the base direction of everything happening here? The first thing Moses does is remind these people that they have something in their midst that is found nowhere else in the world. They have the word of God right in their midst. It's God who has given it to them. God has revealed himself and shown these people the very scope of his love and his marvel and his wonder and his will. The word of God was in their possession, and it is in this word of God that makes this challenge before them realistic, because you see, they didn't have to guess at God's heart and desire. They didn't have to make up anything about God's will and purpose for them, because all of these things were before them. God had given it to them. And in this word that was found among them was also found the power and the motivation to accept and to carry out the challenge now set before them. And what is the challenge? Well, that's found in the very first section of our, very first verse of our section. I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. There it is. Here is the challenge that is found for every soul of this world. The base question, what do you desire? Do you want life or death? Do you want blessings or curses? That's what confronts us in this earthly life. It confronts everyone in this earthly life. Because you see, God has put us here. God has created us unique and wonderful. God has put us in the circumstances we are surrounded with for the sole purpose of meeting and contemplating this challenge, life or death, blessings or curses. But you and I start with that second set first. Do you want blessings or curses? Do you want a world filled with good things, with things positive and upbeat, with the wonders and marvels of God as yours? That's what's being offered. God's blessings, God being with you, God watching over you, God making all things serve for your good, God teaching you contentment, God bringing you joy, God filling your life with his treasures and his riches, not just for now, but for all eternity. Now, I want you to realize that God's blessings can indeed include hardships and trials and difficulties and disease and all the other bland and troublesome things of this world. The point is this. When God is on your side, when God is taking care of you, it's all working and it is all serving for our eternal good and salvation. That's God's promise. God says when he's in your life, he is working to bring you into his kingdom, to make you his child and an heir of eternal life. That's actually why I started with that second set of things, because in reality, this idea of blessing also includes the wonder and the marvel of life. Not just life here, but true life. A life of light and love, of joy and happiness, because you grasp and you know the eternal blessings of God in Jesus. And so the question is simple. Do you want God's blessings? Life? Or do you want curses? A life filled with despair and darkness? A life where hope is fleeting and joy, well, joy is temporary, depending on the fun that's going on. And have you ever noticed that the world's idea of happiness and joy, when fully indulged in, usually leads to destruction and bedevilment? And so I say, go ahead. Follow the world and its desires. Go ahead. Do drugs and alcohol. Have sex with everyone and everything. Live only for the moment and its thrill. Make sure all your lusts and all your desires, all your wants and all your perversities are met. And pretty soon you will find your life is really one big sinkhole. Seriously, just look around at the world. The curses are horrid and they lead only to death. Not just physical death, but death in the sense of permanent separation from God. Of death where there is no longer a single trace of God's love or light, but just the darkness, the despair, and the horror of hell. Is that what you want? Curses and death? Notice that that next line of this section just pleads with you. Literally, it begs you to make the right choice. It says, now choose life. You know, you and I get a little lost in thinking of this because we really don't know what the truth of life is as it's found in Scripture sometimes. You see, that's why I pointed you to the base of all of this, to God's Word. God's Word directs you in and to life. God's Word shows you the path and then directs you on that path. God's Word provides the motivation and the strength and the hope of this life. Let me remind you exactly how. For the Jews, they had the law of God. That law was basically designed to point out sin and the fact that we can't measure up to God's demand of perfection. But the law of God also contained the ceremonial laws, those laws of worship and service to God that were designed to point to the grace, the mercy, and the love of God found in the promised Savior and His work. See, those people of the Old Testament, they weren't left hopeless. They were directed to the same source that you and I are directed to, the Savior. The promised Redeemer of God who would cleanse our sins, grant us a whole new status before God, and yes, who would offer us surely and wonderfully the gift of life. The only difference is that the Jewish people were looking forward to their Savior, and you and I look back to the Savior and His work. Either way, whether you are speaking about the Old Testament people or New Testament people, the means of salvation is exactly the same. It would be the Savior. God's grace and mercy and life revealed in the Savior. So to choose life means to turn to that Word of God. To hear the promises of God, to listen to the fact that God has and God continues to declare His love and grace to us in every way. God knows our sinful condition. God knows that we are dead in trespass and sin, and God, in love, took every step, to give us this life. He did it completely and fully in Jesus. Yeah, that's the same old thing that your pastor repeats again and again, that Jesus lived the perfect life that we could not live, that Jesus offered Himself on the cross in our stead, that there He was paying for our sins, and thus we are granted eternal life and the gift of forgiveness. but it's not boring, and it's not garbage. It's the awesome and marvelous truth of God. See, now when I speak of life, I, in my own mind, based upon what God's word says, I think of the results, the two results of life that Jesus brings us. First, this life that Jesus brings me contentment and happiness in my earthly life. No matter what is going on, struggle or difficulty, up or down, no matter what is going on, I always know that Jesus is with me, that Jesus is watching over me, and he's guarding me, and he's leading me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Simply put, with Jesus on my side, there is nothing I can't take and nothing that I fear or dread. All of this because, as St. Paul says in the book of Romans, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. And when I think of life a second way, I know it to mean the eternal life that is found in and with Jesus. The glory of heaven that is mine in Jesus. The wonders of eternal perfection cradled by the Lord God in a perfect and perpetual state of holiness and wonder. All because of Jesus. See, this is life, the true life that Jesus gives. And did you hear what our text said? The Lord is your life. That's what Jesus is, our life. And if we don't grasp or understand his total blessing in our life, the life he is for us and causes in us, then I have to say your faith is having a problem. Our life in Jesus is sure and certain and awesome in every way. Yes. Jesus is our life. And finally, our last part speaks to us of love. As we speak of the life we have in Jesus, of the wonder and awe of salvation, sure and free because of his victory, the end result is love. But remember, we love because he first loved us. In Jesus, we are free to grasp true love. We are free to practice that love, to know that love, to be moved and motivated by that love. It is God's love poured upon us through the Holy Spirit, who works in us through the gospel and word and sacrament. Love, true and wonderful, love from God that as we grasp it and have it fill us, it just makes this world bearable and better. Because in truth, God's love in our lives makes our lives absolutely better. The text simply encourages us, love the Lord your God, listen to his voice, and hold fast to him. You see, that love that we have from God is one where we listen, and in listening, we hold steadfast. It is so because we grasp that we are filled with love from God. Yes, God fills us and moves us to grasp his majesty and believe what the Holy Spirit does in us through the Word of God. And again, this love makes our life better. And if you don't believe me, then I simply say, well, why don't you go out there and ask those husband and wives of our congregation who practice and who know this love. Ask those kids whose parents are the very example of God's love in their lives. Ask them how comforting, ask those kids how comforting and empowering it is that the love of Christ is shared and practiced in their lives. And I could go on and on with how this love of God impacts us and changes us. How it colors our world and gives us hope and peace. How it balances out in our favor the struggles and the turmoils of this world because love overcomes all. This love is seen and fully realized most in Jesus and what he has done for us. The bottom line, dear people, I don't think you and I would know how to love. I don't think you and I would even begin to grasp love until you have grasped the wonder of Jesus. Because his love overflows and his love abounds in our lives in everything for our good. So there is the challenge. What shall it be? Life or death? Blessings and curses? God's gift of life and love? Or what the world offers? I say with the Lord, choose life. Amen.